Hey everyone, welcome to our first lesson for membership. In this video, we're going to be talking about the gospel. Now, this may seem like a basic concept, but we believe it's so foundational that we're going to spend a couple videos explaining our relationship to the gospel right at the start here of our membership training. The question we are answering in this lesson and in the next is, how do we at Gateway view the gospel? So here at Gateway, we love the Bible. So we're going to spend most of our time in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and really only on the first four verses. And we're going to see six things about how we ought to view the gospel based on this passage. Now, after these first two videos, we're going to talk specifically what is the content of that gospel. But this lesson is broader than that. In this lesson, we are discussing how does Gateway view the gospel. Okay? So six things. And here they are. They're going to come on the screen right now. And we're going to cover the first three in this video and then the next three, the last three in the next video. All right. So go ahead and take a look. You can pause the video right now as they come on the screen. You can write them down if you need. They're in your workbook. And again, they come right out of 1 Corinthians 15 verses 1 through 4. Okay. Which is also in your workbook. You can check that and follow along. So I'm going to read off the first six lists and then I'm going to read the passage of scripture next. So six things about how Gateway views the gospel according to 1 Corinthians 15. Number one, we believe the gospel is number one priority. It's not one of several important things. It is number one priority, importance. Number two, we believe the gospel is for the church to grow. It's not just for non-believers to get saved. It's for the church to grow. Number three, we believe the gospel is good news about Jesus. It's not good advice for you to do. It's about Jesus. It's good news, not good advice. Number four, we believe the gospel is found in the whole Bible, including the Old Testament. So the Old Testament is not just a moral code, or the New Testament is not just about being a good person. The whole Bible is about the gospel. Number five, the gospel is about salvation or rescue, specifically from wrath. And so it's not about correct behaviors or even right beliefs. The gospel is about salvation. And then finally, number six, the gospel demands a response. It's not something you can be neutral about, not something you can kind of shrug your shoulders and say, eh, no big deal. Okay? Those six things, we see those in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 4. And before we begin, once again, I'm going to read this verse for you. I'm going to read this passage for you, and then I will be referring to it throughout our lesson. So 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 4 says this. Paul is speaking to the church at Corinth. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. Okay, we need to start off by saying, number one, that the gospel is the number one priority. It's not just one of many important things. It's the number one priority. The gospel is of first importance, according to verse 3. Paul elsewhere says that he made it his aim to only preach Christ crucified. This is because Christ is the whole entire point of Christianity. A Christless Christianity is reduced to theology, knowledge, or morality, ethics. But that's not really the heartbeat of Christianity. It is our aim to keep first things first. It is our aim at our church to keep the gospel of Jesus the first and most important thing at Gateway. See, our church will not get distracted in details about the end times or what color carpet we should have or how many angels can dance on the pin of a needle, right? Some of those things may be important, some are not important, but for us, we're going to focus long and hard on the gospel. That's so important for us. It's of first importance according to the Bible. We really want to keep the main thing the main thing. This is pretty obvious and something I think most people probably take for granted. So we're going to move on to our second point, which will only make this point even more powerful. Okay, so point number two, the gospel is not only of first importance, but the gospel, number two, is for the church to grow. It's not just for non-believers to get saved, but in some ways, it's the thing that continues to save the church. So notice here in this passage that Paul is speaking to the church, to brothers and sisters, or people already considered part of the family of God. He's not talking to non-Christians and non-believers. He's talking to Christians, and he's reminding them of the gospel, because the gospel is not just for non-believers to get saved. It's also for the church to continue to grow and be transformed. Now, I'm not kidding when I say that this is one of the biggest concerns that I see in many churches today. Many churches wrongly assume that the gospel is what you give non-believers, and that believers need other things like prayer and Bible reading and training in evangelism in order to grow. And I want to be clear, there's nothing wrong with those kinds of things or spiritual disciplines. Those are all very important, in fact. But the Bible repeatedly tells us that the way we grow as Christians is the same way we became a Christian, by the person and work of Jesus. That is, by the gospel of Jesus, we as the church grow to be all that God wants us to be. See, even in this passage, Paul says that the gospel is not only something that these believers received, right, and believed, past tense, but that it is something that they are currently standing in, something by which they are currently ongoing being saved by. In other words, the gospel is not just about our past sins being forgiven, and it's not just about our future destiny going to heaven. The gospel is incredibly practical right now in the everyday stuff of life. This may be one of the biggest emphases you experience here at Gateway. So I'm going to drill down deeper before we move forward because it is one of the things that drives us as a church. Okay, so let me clarify a little more. Now, certainly we believe that the gospel moves you from unsaved to saved, past tense. But what we are saying is we also believe the gospel keeps on saving you in an ongoing process. We must learn to share the gospel not just with outsiders, but with insiders, with the church. In some ways, we could say that we're all still non-believers, in the sense that we all still lack faith. In fact, one person cried out to Jesus a prayer that's incredibly powerful. This person said, "I believe, but help me in my unbelief." Now, that's a prayer that every Christian must learn to pray. My faith is still lacking. My belief is still lacking. There are still parts of my heart that do not believe the goodness of the good news. So if I perfectly believed in all that God has done and all that God is for me in the gospel, I would never sin. But what my sin does is it shows that deep inside, I still don't have the faith I need. I still don't have the belief I need, the commitment to God that He has for me. And so that's why we still need the good news of Jesus to build us up. Let me show you this from another passage in the Bible in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. It says, "Speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into Jesus, who is the head, into Christ." Now, if you've been in church culture, if you've been around church for a while, perhaps you've heard this verse used whenever someone feels the need to confront you, right? They come up to you like, "Hey, brother, I have to speak the truth in love to you here. You know, you've been missing out on Bible study or small groups, and, you know, I just want to call you out." Right? Or, "Hey, sister, you know, I really, you know, you're really mean to sister so-and-so, and I'm here to speak the truth and love to you," you know. Or they may even say something trivial like, "Hey, you have something in your teeth, but don't kill the messenger, you know, I'm just speaking the truth and love," right? Now, listen, it's a good idea to confront others, to speak truth into their lives. That's all good and right. But this passage is not teaching that. If you look at the context in verse 21, it says, "The truth is in Jesus." So in other words, speaking the truth that is in Jesus in love is how we build up the body in Christ. That's how we grow up in Christ, speaking the truth of Jesus to the body. So here's like a metaphor that might help you. The gospel can be seen as a sort of language, a heavenly language. And you can speak it in any known earthly language, but it comes with specific ideas, phrases, words. And this language is about a man named Jesus. And the whole story centers not on what we do, but on what he has already done. And the Bible here is teaching that we must grow fluent in speaking this language to the church, to one another. That's our whole job. Not to call each other out or spout verses off that make us feel guilty or that show us that we ought to live a certain way so that people can be saved. But rather, we're supposed to build each other by telling one another about all that Jesus has done for us and who he is to us now. That's how we grow as believers. We speak Jesus into every situation and so that we can grow to be more like Jesus. Does that make sense? In other words, to use churchy language, the gospel is not only the thing that evangelizes the lost world, but it edifies the church in Christ. The gospel not only is to reach the world, but first to renew the church. The gospel is not only for outsiders, but first for insiders. So we are so passionate about building everything all about the gospel in order to build the church God's way, We want Gateway to be God's way, and so we want the gospel to be center. Let me try to explain this one more way, because again, it is so important that you understand this. If you spend the rest of your life getting to know God, you're going to learn more and more about how truly perfect He is. His perfect standard, His character, it can become so clear. And in contrast, you're going to look at yourself and your not so perfect life, and you're going to become more aware that you're different than God. Okay? Kind of like a vanity mirror. When you light up a vanity mirror is a mirror that has light bulbs all around it, right? Now, the best and worst thing about a vanity mirror is that it exposes your blemishes. It shows you the ugly, right? If you look like me. The truth is, God is like a light, and in Him is no darkness. But we are dark. So when we get closer to the light, our ugly hearts and attitudes, our actions and inactions clearly display our sinfulness. So as we grow in our understanding of God, getting closer to Him, we also will grow in our understanding of our sinful selves. God lights up our imperfections by His perfection. You see what I'm saying? So growing closer to God is kind of a paradox, because you also become more aware of your own sinfulness. And so what's going to happen is there's going to be this experience of this gap between you and God. As you grow more aware of His holiness, you will grow more aware of your sinfulness. And this gap has to be dealt with somehow. It can't be ignored, right? No one wants to be a hypocrite. So you can try really hard to work your way to reduce this gap. But at the end of the day, that's only going to show how impossibly far you are from God. You're going to be really exhausted and tired, burned out. The better, more biblical answer is the way to solve the gap, what we might call the gospel gap, is to let Jesus save you from yourself. Let Him grow you by forgiving you and setting you free from your sin. Only Jesus can help you deal with the gap. So the more you grow in knowing who God is, and the more you become aware of all the junk and sin in your life, the more you're going to become aware and appreciative and treasure Jesus as your Savior. This is going to crush all of your pride, fortify all of your insecurity, and friends, Jesus has done it. This is such an empowering gospel of transformation. Don't you see that? Doesn't that make sense? This is why the gospel gap is so important to know, is you're going to grow in this, and you're going to need to deal with it. And this is how you do. So we're so passionate here at our church about applying the gospel to the gospel gap in believers and not just non-believers. All right, I want to move on to our third point now. Our third and final point of this video, number three, the gospel is good news about Jesus. It's not good advice for you to do, okay? So the gospel is important, and it's important to build the church, but 1 Corinthians 15 also teaches us the gospel that it's news. It repeatedly calls it that, right? Paul himself kind of views himself as like a mailman, not an author. He says, listen, I received it and I passed it on. He doesn't say that he wrote it. He doesn't say that he edited it. He just said, I just announced the news that I was told. What this means is that the gospel is not man-made good advice. The gospel is God-given good news. So listen, the gospel is not just good advice for you to do. It's good news that God has declared over you. In other words, we're not calling people to more prayer or more good works or more good behaviors. What we're actually calling people to do is to more Jesus. Okay? The gospel is not a prayer that you pray. It's not correct information that you have. The gospel is not, you know, what would Jesus do? The gospel asks, what has Jesus already done? The gospel is not baptism. The gospel is not an altar call. The gospel is not a mindset that you adopt. The gospel is not a strategy. The gospel is not principles. The gospel is not even strictly speaking a belief system. The gospel is not a program. The gospel is good news about what God has done in Jesus to save you. In other words, the gospel is about the God-man, Jesus Christ. And the point of the gospel is that you now get to have a relationship with God because of what Jesus, the God-man, has done and who that Jesus is. So one more thing about this. Since it's news, it really doesn't matter if you like it or not, if you believe it or not. It is what it is. It's true, right? If I get true news that my wife has totaled our new car in a car crash, she calls me, she delivers this news. It's not good news, it's bad news, but she tells me, listen, I got in an accident. It doesn't really matter if I say, well, I disagree, you know? at the end of the day, it's either happened or it didn't. It's either true or it's not. Well, the gospel works this way. It's news. So you don't make it good by believing it. It's good news in and of itself. It's good news for you to believe it because it'll be good for you. But the gospel in and of itself is simply good news regardless of how you even respond to it. What makes the gospel good is that God has done it. Okay, church, those are the first 3 points of our video. In the next video, we want you to check out, we're going to cover the next 3 points from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, going through the first 4 verses. I hope you watch that video and learn something.